down. Don't need, don't bring me down. Don't bring me down. Don't need, don't bring me down. Don't bring me down. Don't need, don't bring me down. Don't bring me down. Don't tell me our youth is running out. It's only just begun. Don't tell me our youth is running out. It's only just begun. Don't tell me our youth is running out. It's only just begun. Begun, begun, begun.
Fear no evil. Fear no evil. And that's exactly the attitude you will have when in your hands you possess a Smith & Wesson M&P-15 series of rifle. Specifically, as we're looking at here, the Smith & Wesson M&P-15T or Tactical model. Hello again, this is Ultimatehistorybuff1, and finally, from what I've been promising for over a year now, this is the complete review on my Smith & Wesson M&P-15 series rifle. Welcome again, hope you check out my other videos if you are new, and if you aren't, and you are a subscriber, thank you very much. I love doing these videos, and I don't get any kickbacks. I do this all on my own time, and this is fun for me. This is recreation, so I'm not an official reviewer. So if I make some mistakes, well, we'll just all have to get over it and never mind them. So we know the rifle we're looking at here, but what are we getting out of it? Well, track record is undeniable. Smith & Wesson has made a name for themselves in the military and police series. They've been doing so for decades. Many people think that the military and police, the M&P series, is something new with their striker-fired pistols and their AR-15 series of rifles. But that's not the case. Smith & Wesson has had a military and police series that they have called, at least, for many years, going all the way back to the 1960s. I looked in a Shooter's Bible catalog, and for around $60 to $80, depending upon the model, make, and finish, you could pick yourself up a .38 or .357 Magnum revolver from Smith & Wesson underneath their military, police, and military line. Wait, that was two militaries. Excuse me. I guess it would be military and police then. Anyhow, this is my first run at this review. We're gonna see how it goes. Guys, the camera's running, and I am a jabberin'. Let's go over the simple stuff first, the general things that we should get out of the way. This model we're looking at, of course, I'll repeat it again, is the M&P-15T. Your standard variant, if you live in a free state, is going to come with a 30-round P-MAG. It is going to come equipped with front and rear mag pull polymer folding sights. They do a fairly good job. I'm always able to hit accurately with them. I've never had a problem with durability. Some people have. If you want to change them out, you don't like them, change them out. I mean, to me, you're getting a free $100 pair of sights when it comes down to it. Or you can tag them into the price and say, well, you're paying for the sights with it. Continuing on, got a standard barrel length of 16 inches. This is a carbine gas system. And you're going to have, and this is the very critical part that I find that really sets this on its own away from other AR-15 variants, is this is a solid contour barrel. It's going to thin down a little bit underneath the handguard or underneath the rail behind the gas block, but for the most part it's going to be a 0.754 diameter barrel. And it's going to be melanite treated. There is no chrome lining. The whole barrel, all the steel parts on this gun are melanited. That is like a nitride style finish. It is extremely durable. You want more information, check out Smith & Wesson or call them with their customer service and ask them more about it. Barrel interior is a 4140 steel. Some people are picky about their steels when it comes to their firearms. Me, not so much. If it works, it works, and it does work well. One thing that is great about this rifle is it comes with a 1/8 inch twist rate. That means you're going to be able to stabilize everything from very light bullets all the way to very heavy bullets relatively well. Your middle grains, anywhere from 55 up to about 68, are going to be your bread and butter grains for this rifle, what the 1/8 twist is going to like. However, you may find that your Smith & Wesson likes to throw 77s or 45 grainers very, very well, and you shoot them very well. Again, every rifle is its own, but with generalities, the 1/8 twist is going to cover pretty much everything you're going to come across commercially, unless, of course, you're hand loading or you're working on specific hunting or target loads. You're looking at 7075 T6 aluminum receiver, upper and lower. And one unique feature of the Smith & Wesson series, now I know all the rifles have them, but they're manufactured receivers that they do themselves, as far as it is my understanding, will have this swooped trigger guard. This is one integral piece. This isn't an addition. This isn't an aftermarket part that they slap in there. This is part of the receiver. Now that's not mil-spec, and some people may complain about that, but really, is there any difference? This receiver is exactly the same, except they didn't take the time to machine the little ears and put in a little metal or plastic part. To me, that's more robust. In fact, if you look right there, that little white spot, yeah, that's where a 1911 magazine, fully loaded, dropped onto this rifle. Don't ask me how it did it. Basically, it just fell off the top of a gun cabinet while this was leaning up next to the gun cabinet and dinged it. Could that have been a failure on a normal rifle? Probably not. But it is a testament to how strong that bridge is. That trigger guard is very, very unique. It is a Smith & Wesson contour. No other manufacturers really do that. There are manufacturers that do place into their rifles that kind of trigger guard. It's right machined into the receiver. But Smith & Wesson has this very elegant swoop. You don't even notice it until you're handling it for a little bit. And it is very efficient. Fits gloves very well. Your bolt is magnetic particle tested and high pressure tested. And you will receive with it a 6-position telescoping stock and buffer tube assembly. This rifle did not come stock with that. And in fact, is a neutered rifle, or was. Hence why there is no muzzle device. This was originally a New York compliant rifle. So, once I was in a state where I could legally possess this rifle with all the features that a normal, free American can have, I, of course, replaced it with the Brownell 6-position buffer tube and the Magpul MOE stock. And just in case you're wondering, the sling that this is wearing is a U.S. Grunt Gear battle sling. Excellent sling, review in the future perhaps, if I have the interest. and the time. Wearing an also EOTech 512 AA battery model, Magpul handguards, plus the standard Smith & Wesson equipped handguard covers, rail covers, and a Magpul AFG2, the slimmer variant. Originally, this came with a 10-round ASC box magazine. Great for the bench, not so great for self-preservation. Anyhow, there we're getting into politics. What else does this come with? Well, it comes with a very nice cardboard box, padded with foam with a Smith & Wesson logo on it with M&P-15 stamp on the side of the box. Otherwise, you get this general manual. It's not specific to this rifle, just their series of rifles. And you get, of course, your lock. I never really use these. Only when I've been transporting them have I used these. Across state lines, I'll lock up a firearm, both in a case or a safe and with an action lock, just so you're triple positive. It does come with a sight adjustment tool for the forward sight for the Magpul folding sight. Has a little, they include the card there, so they do install these at the factory, and they are nice enough to give you the reading material with it. If you ever get bored, you can always read your Smith & Wesson manual while you're on the toilet at hunting camp or on a long car trip, I guess, to the range. General disassembly. There's good pictures. It is in black and white. Lots of warnings, lots of general information about your rifle. It covers both the direct impingement and the gas piston variants of the Smith & Wesson M&P-15 rifle series. Covering it there. Basic operations, etc. It's not the flashiest, it's not the most awesome, but it is thorough. It is a good manual in general. Why have I put the gloves on? Well, I've put these Mechanics Wear gloves on, which I love, by the way. Thank you, Nut Fancy, for doing a review on those. They are awesome. I finally was able to get myself a pair for Christmas. They were gifted to me. Anyhow, because we're going to take this apart, and yes, you safety Sallys, you safety Nazis who have been worrying about the loaded magazine here, the rifle is not chambered. The rifle will, of course, be useless without a loaded magazine. That is a 30-round Gen 2 Magpul loaded with some federal manufactured NATO cartridges there. 55 grain ball, just some standard stuff, which is kind of hard to come by these days. If you'll notice, the rifle is a little dirty. Let's see if we can get some light on that. It is a little dark in here. Lighting today being done by a mag light. The little mini mag light. If you can see here, there we go. The rifle is relatively dirty, and that is because I took it out today and did the final torture test, and it is super sticky. So, that's why I have the gloves on, and that's where we're going to be rolling into reliability. But before I do that, let's just give that call sign. Your MSRP is going to be $11.59. This rifle was bought for $10.99 at Dick's Sporting Goods, excuse me, back in April of 2012. So I have had this in my possession for 2 years, and round count is approximately 3,000, a little bit under, not quite there yet. And over over two-thirds of that has been steel cased, mostly Talamo, also Wolf, and also Magtech, if I've pronounced that correctly. I think that's the company's name. I don't have any on hand there. I can't remember. Only other significant things to note is your chrome components are going to be your bolt carrier and your gas key. Pretty standard there. And your call number for the Smith & Wesson catalog, if you want to find out more about this rifle from them, is going to be 811-041. Again, 811-041. Again, I'm not endorsed a shooter for. I'm not an employee of Smith & Wesson or any of the guns that companies that I review their products. It's just, this is a good product, and that is why I am reviewing it. Anyhow, reliability, excellent. My first failure that was not self-induced by myself, and this rifle has only suffered two. One, because I put way too much debris and dirt into the action, which the bolts couldn't rotate, so I had to rack it multiple times to get the brass cartridge out, so it was a brass case round, and clear the dirt out of the barrel extension. No AR-15 is going to survive excessive dirt in the barrel extension. That's why when you load your magazine, if you like to do torture tests, because you're an idiot or you are a reviewer like me, you want to shake off the heavy dirt that's clogging the magazine that you just put in there. You want dust, because in reality, you're not going to shove pond muck, a pond muck filled magazine, up into your rifle. If you do and you expect it to work, you're either under extremely high stress and a complete idiot in battlefield conditions, or that's just it, you're a complete idiot. No rifle is really going to survive that. An AK, maybe, because it's got a lot of room, but each rifle has its tolerances. This is a sealed system, therefore the AR-15 is not going to tolerate a lot of debris all up in there. You're not going to be able to shove your ham sandwich inside the action and expect the rifle to work. So, again, rifle is clear. We're going to break this thing open and show you just the amount of dirt there. We're going to get ourselves around because this thing is a little bit tough. There we go. We're going to open that up. Standard AR-15 field stripping disassembly. Let's bring the MagTech mini light back. As you can see, perhaps much easier in person, but that bolt carrier group is absolutely filthy. That's why I have my gloves on. It's covered in oil, debris, powder residue, but it is excellent for a bolt carrier group that has gone through almost 3,000 rounds, some in fast fire, some in standard fire, some in hunting conditions, all that goodness that a standard rifle will go through. It's in great shape. Charging handle is a standard AR-15 charging handle, nothing special about that. I did replace the latch with a Badger Tech ordnance. Their Model 2 latch, I believe it is. Don't quote me on that, but if you want to find out, go to Badger Tech Ordnance. It's a website. M4 feed wraps are in this rifle. I'm not going to show you that because it's a difficult shot and there is no point of me fumbling the rifle around in front of the camera. Let me get this reassembled here. You have a standard carbine buffer. There is no marking on it. You have a standard action return spring. Your hammer is going to be pretty good. I don't know about the current models, but you can kind of see in there that silver part. The internal components were polished a little bit and finished up better than a standard mil-spec component. I did, however, replace the stock springs with the JP Enterprises reduced power springs, which brought the weight of the trigger down by probably a pound and a quarter, pound and a half. Which is quite significant, and it makes me a lot better shooter with it. Let me just get these patches out of the way here. So, back to reliability. The only other failure I had today, and that will be in B-roll footage, which you will be seeing in this review, either before or after, it stopped up, and I couldn't break the action myself. I had to collapse the stock and bang it on the ground a little bit. What that was a steel case round by Wolf WPA line, and it was not quite spec. It seemed to be a little bit swollen, and again, to see if I could get it to function in the rifle, I loaded it back into a magazine and slammed the bolt home. The only other bobble I had today, which you will see on camera, is I was pulling the trigger and it felt like it didn't reset, and that was during putting the dirt into the action, but I figured that was my fault. And especially when I reviewed the footage, as I didn't completely release the trigger as I was trying to pull it again. It was a very audible reset. Again, action is clear, safety off. And again, if you don't see, I had a half pull there instead of a full pull, letting it go back forward and coming back. There's about a little over a quarter inch of travel for your trigger. It's basically a stock trigger, guys. There's nothing special about it. Let's see, what's next? What's next? Accuracy, of course, accuracy. It's pretty standard, guys. As far as AR-15s go with free-floated, this is a proprietary free-float rail. It's very solidly mounted. I have had no troubles with it. I have taken it off in the past. I have not done so in over a year. It requires you simple Allen keys to unscrew. Then you pull off the front. It's very nice. The barrel nut gives a nice position. It's flared out like on a standard AR handguard, which gives you that spot to really pull your hand back into. It is knurled. Very good texture on it. You do have T-marked rails on top of the rifle. There's T4 kind of sticking out underneath from between the Embus and the Eotech. Again, all internal components except for the springs for the trigger are stock. I've done nothing to this rifle other than that, other than also replacing the buffer tube, but that's not really a critical part. So the accuracy with a scope is relatively good. At 100 yards, you're probably going to be looking about 1 MOA, maybe slightly sub MOA. And, you know, for a carbine, that's quite acceptable. I mean, from a bench with the right cartridge or the proper hand loads, this rifle, of course, probably provide half MOA or better, especially with a really great shooter. If you upgrade that trigger to something like a Timney or a Geissele, you know, you get a 3-pound trigger in there, put a great scope on it, get the right ammunition running through it, and I can bet you that this gun will make 5-round groups of a half MOA all day long, especially with the target crown that's on this specific rifle. I believe that was only really offered in the compliant New York versions pre-SAFE Act. However, there might be some California compliant variants that feature the same muzzle features and are non-threaded. I would check Smith & Wesson's website for that, of course, for any other questions which are not answered in this review. Accuracy, you know, like I said, very acceptable, guys. It's not something that is crazy. I'm not going to lie to you and say, oh, this gun is freaking this, that, and the other thing, but this is a very capable 1 MOA rifle. If you do your part, you find the right ammunition, this will do it. One impressive feat that I had, and you're going to have to take my word for it, I don't have any footage of it, is when I first purchased this rifle in the spring of 2012, all I was shooting was Talamo at the time. In fact, I didn't put brass-cased ammunition through this rifle until about the 800 round mark. And I was sitting at 325 yards, no optics, just these Embus sights, and I was able to nail a steel plate and get a 3-inch, 3-round group out of it. And that wasn't rapid succession, that was taking my time. I couldn't believe I had hit it the first time, aimed the exact same spot, hit it again, fired a third time, went and checked my target. Sure enough, I had hit that steel plate 3 times in a row with a 3-inch group. Is that a fluke or just the stars aligning? I don't know. But that proved to me that this rifle is extremely capable, and that was pre-reduced power springs, too. The only thing you might find with reduced power springs is JP Enterprises warns you about, and of course I'm saying this as it hits my mind, sorry if this review is getting a little jumbled, but they can cause light primer strikes. I've not really experienced that. With an asterisk there, I have had several Talamo rounds in recent months not go off, but that seems to be ammunition quality. That's not really a power quality, because all brass case rounds that I've ever used, whether foreign or domestic manufacturer, have gone off on the first trigger pull. If that's in battery and there's one in the chamber, it's going bang. And that's part of your reliability there. And of course the question comes, is this rifle a WROL, a SHTF rifle? Is it that kind of carbine? Yes. Not only yes, but absolutely. This is something that you can really depend on. And if you know your AR-15 platform, or this is going to be your first rifle, this is a great purchase. The Smith & Wesson M&P-15 Sport is going to be your economy version of this. Of course, they're not going to have magnetic parallel-tested bolt. They're not going to high-pressure test it. It's going to be pretty much slapped together with high quality, but it's going to be slapped together and be economy parts on it. Of course, if you want to see a full review of that, go check out Nothing Fancy's review of it. And there are multiple other reviews of this. Nobody's really done a review of this specific rifle yet. They've all done reviews on the Sport. Some have done reviews on the piston model, but none of them have been very in-depth. This is simply a great rifle, and that's really what I want to put out there. If you are thinking about a Smith & Wesson, compared to others, I would say it's an excellent candidate, but of course you're going to be the end decision maker in that. I would push to say that yes, the tactical variant is one of the best. The handguard is, however, a little bit outdated, a little bit heavy. This rifle is coming in, I believe, stock. They're advertising 6.85 pounds, equipped as you see it here. It's much closer to 9 pounds. It might even be heavier than that, but that's really with this optic. And this optic weighs about 12 or 13 ounces, this EOTech. That is a lot of weight. You take this off and this rifle really does lighten up. You get rid of these polymer rails, you strip it down to a very little red dot, maybe a micro red dot, and you're looking about 6.8, maybe 7 pounds, which is good, but it's not the best. Are you looking for a tank? Are you looking for an armored personnel carrier? Are you looking for a Jeep? I guess with the analogy B to put on AR-15 rifles. What weight class do you want? And you need to remember that weight can equal controllability, because this doesn't have a muzzle device, especially so. You know, this 9-pound rifle can handle better than a 6-pound one with a birdcage on it, because I know how to manage the weight, and also it settles the rifle down after every shot. Again, I'm kind of stringing along here with a bunch of different information thrown at you guys fast, but that's how my reviews go. I do it as it hits me. let's see, where am I going with this thought? Yes, that's where I'm going. All right, I'm back on track. This rifle is a moderate weight. Are there heavier AR-15s? Absolutely. You can throw so much crap on your AR-15s, or that come stock that really are not coming in at 6.8 pounds. They might come in at 7.5. Of course, the objective is to be as light as possible for SWAC, size and weight constraints. Did I say SWAC? It'd be SAW&C. There goes that acronym again. I don't know, I think I've run you down on the skinny about this rifle, guys. It's really an excellent rifle. It is a standard AR-15 for all intents and purposes. And it has a little extra to give you. It is a great option. There are so many options on this on the market there today. And this is made in the USA. You know, a lot of the rifles that are being made during the scare are made cheaper by smaller companies, are using imported parts. They are using substandard parts sometimes. And I think we're really going to see that as an issue. One thing I had noticed about the M&P-15 Sports is that over the time of this past year and a half, because they've been putting out the production so fast, the quality has come down a little bit. They aren't doing the 1-in-8 barrels, but really, if you place an order from Smith & Wesson, you should get the proper rifle. The camera is running out of battery, guys. I think I've babbled enough. The rest of the video and the entry to the video, the tactical entry to this video, the intro to this video will tell you a lot. You'll see this rifle in action. You know, thanks for watching, guys. Tune in again soon. And as always, God bless and keep your powder dry. This has been the review of the Smith & Wesson M&P-15T by Ultimate History Buff 1. I'm signing off, guys. See ya.
All right. Okay. Looks pretty good. Brush her out, get her shake. Six rounds, she closed good. It didn't reset. She worked fine. I just had a little bit of trouble there with the trigger. That was my bad. There she goes. 3,000 rounds later. Let's see somebody else do that round count. Granted, that was over 2 years. But we had one stoppage today. Sure that. It's a wolf kick. It looked to be a little slow. I had it forced in, but once I, with the, actually I didn't use the full assist. I just dropped the bolt on it to see if it would go in, and it actually ended up doing it, and when I fired it, It extracted fine, but it didn't throw very far, so my thoughts are it was an overswelled case. So, just to show you the bolt carrier group, let's take a look at that. Absolutely filthy, guys. Probably about 80 rounds of ammo, 60 of it steel case, 20 of it. Of that grass, shitload of dirt.